for your wonderful word. We thank you for your wonderful word, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for the teacher tonight, David Cam, who has studied your word diligently and has found many wonderful things that you've got there for us. Let us be able to understand what you want to tell us tonight, Lord, and help us, Lord, to understand that the bridegroom is getting ready to come and get his bride. We don't know when, but the way things are going, time is marching on, and every day is one day closer to your return. Help us, Lord, to open up our hearts and prepare our hearts to understand the deep meanings of what David is going to share tonight, because the Jewish wedding, the ancient Jewish wedding, tells us a lot about how you're going to do it when the time comes for us. Amen. So thank you, Lord, for everything. And thank you, Lord, that you will bless everyone who is joined tonight to hear this wonderful message, and bless our speaker abundantly, Lord, and help us, Lord, to understand the great depths of your love for us. We ask this in the name of Yeshua, our Messiah, and soon coming Lord, Savior, and King. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. We'll do the shofar at the end. But I'm sure that we'll have some time for Sister Shalom and Sister Helena to assist us with the shofar later on. So thank you very much. Beautiful. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Okay. Welcome, everyone. Tonight's teaching will be a very interesting teaching that many of you may not have heard of. How many of you have heard of this analogy between the ancient Jewish wedding and the soon coming of Christ? Put up your hands. You can either do a reaction or put up your hands. Anyone? Yes, no, Barbara, yes. Our teacher, obviously, yes. Not many hands. Of course, Nancy, yes. Joyce, yes, absolutely. And quite a few. So quite a few of you are new. Anna, yes. And Cecilia Kong, yes. So every page of 20 people, we have about two or three, some pages zero. So that's good. I'm very glad that we are reaching out to new people tonight. I am very sure that you will be blessed by this teaching, whether it's through my message or something that the Lord will speak to you subsequently. That's up to the Lord and the Holy Spirit. Praise God. Hallelujah. So this was actually first done in August 2021. It is a deep teaching tonight, and it refers back and reference back to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22 to 23. Okay. So I just want to give a caveat at the beginning. It's okay if you find it fascinating, but are unable to take it all in at once. All right. Especially when I do speak faster, when I tend to get excited. So it's okay. Lip reading. Just kidding. Okay. And then you can go back and listen again and listen again and listen again. And at the end of the day, the Lord, the Holy Spirit will unpack and reveal to you. Amen. So it's not my job. My job is just to point you to the word of God. And this is a very, very exciting subject. Now, there are many of you from Asia, Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, Philippines, and Hong Kong, Andaman Islands, and so on. Hence, I'm going to say tonight, I'm going to add some of my childhood jokes, some Asian slangs, and of course, some Aussie jokes, of course. Please don't get offended or upset. The message may be deep, but it gets really exciting as we progress. Some of you say, would there be videos? Yes, there will be videos. And yes, it will be recorded. Okay. This has actually been recorded, but tonight will be a different version. So there will be part one and part two. So you just want to connect with the audience and say, turn to your neighbor and say, part one and part two. Okay. You can talk to your neighbor, your husband, your grandchildren, bring them. Hey, Joshua, and anyone that is next to you. Okay. So it's going to be part one and part two. Part one will be shorter, part two will be longer. Okay. And we'll take a break in between. So here goes part one. Thanks, Sister Carol. Welcome. So the ancient Jewish wedding teaches us a lot of biblical truth, spiritual truth about three things. Number one, it teaches us God's truth about God's chesed love for us. How many of you know about the word chesed? Anyone? The word chesed is very, very deep. I'll just write it here for you. It's actually like this, okay, with three little vowels here and three little vowels here. And you can turn to your neighbor and you can talk to them and you say chesed. Anyone would like to do that? Can turn to your neighbor and say the word chesed. Turn to your neighbor. So it's not It's not that as if you're shouting, but it's actually chesed. It's a very guttural language. Biblical Hebrew is a very guttural language. Yeah. So turn to your neighbor and say chesed. Sure. Turn to your friend and say chesed. Very good. There we go. Praise God. Okay. So tonight we are actually going to look at God's chesed love for us. And the Jewish, ancient Jewish wedding is actually a rich symbolism pointing to the coming Messiah, as our teacher Miriam has alluded to in the opening prayer. And it's also a lot of deep spiritual truth about the great celebration, the marriage supper of the Lamb. Okay, so everything that I speak tonight will be referenced. And I have put references, at least 1, 2, 3, 4 reference on every single slide. So it's not my teaching. It's actually things that I have learned over the years in this Messianic Hebraic space. Okay, so this wedding thing is actually not a joke. You know, every man, every woman, every culture, every country has their own customs and cultures for wedding. The big question is, man and woman, is it half and half coming together into a marriage? Is it complementary or is it mutually reinforcing? This is just a little segue into the real teaching. I'd like to propose to you something called as a connecto. Turn to your neighbor and say as a connecto. What is actually as a connecto? Now, as a connecto, Joshua, is like two fishes coming together, male fish, female fish, and they become Mr. and Mrs. Fish. There we go. I'm trying to engage Joshua. All right, Joshua is my good neighbor. Okay, but the concept of as a connecto is very interesting. Imagine if there are two handphones and they're all coming together like this. Okay, but what happens with as a connecto is as the two persons come up together, they actually push each other up. So the concept of as a connecto is not just a spouse, but it's actually very close to what the Bible translates as a helpmate. So both coming together, both strengthening each other. And I think that's going to happen as we progress and we look at these very important lessons. Okay, so beautiful. Let's go on to the next one. So if you look at the Chinese custom over here, did you see a little Chinese custom over here? Well, actually, that's double happiness. So the ancient Jewish people, the ancient Chinese people also know about the as a connecto as well in a to a lesser or greater degree. Yeah. And you can see there's actually lots of drawings here. I actually have a matchstick here that says, you know, double happiness. So there we go. So by the way, Chuck Missler talked about this basis of marriage, the four bases of marriage, or what we call BASES, right? So there's a biological basis where people come together and have children, progenies. The second basis of marriage is psychological, where people come together and support one another. You'll be very surprised to know, you know, sometimes when one spouse passed away, the other one actually gets lonely. And so they marry, not for the sake of procreation because they're 86, but sometimes you hear of stories in a nursing home, you know, two couples, 85 and 82, and they come together. Oh, I love you. You love me. And they get to get together and get married. So it's a very interesting phenomenon that God has actually given us like an as a connecto from a psychological perspective. Sociological perspective, people just come together because they want companionship. It is not surprising. But tonight, we're going to dig deep. So bring out your Bible, hold on to your cup of coffee or red wine, because at the end of the day, we're going to explore and unravel some of the supernatural and spiritual connections and the basis for marriage, particularly from the ancient Hebraic wedding. So the two stages in the wedding, this is very important. And some of this will be a bit technical, but I encourage you to, if you can't write it down, don't worry. We'll give out the entire set of notes tonight, okay? So I'm one of those people where I'm not afraid to share my notes. In fact, if you find mistakes, that's great. We can reiterate, improve on it, and it gets better. Okay, so I'm not afraid to share my notes. I'm not afraid to share my recording. I actually do not even want offering for tonight. I just want to share this because this is a very important teaching that needs to be released to the world. Stage one is Kiddushin. Turn to your neighbor and say Kiddushin. That's a very important exercise. Welcome, Sister Amelia. Kiddushin, all right? So turn to your neighbor and say Kiddushin. All this will slowly come together like jigsaw puzzle and it will make perfect sense. So that stage one, Kiddushin, also known as Erushin. Stage two is Nisuin, or otherwise it's spelled with a Nun Shin, Vav, Aleph, Vav, Yod, and final Nun, okay? So there's two stage here in the ancient Jewish wedding. Now, part one is actually Erushin. This is where the betrothal takes place. If you want to refer to the Bible verse, it's actually in 2 Samuel 3:14 and Luke 1:27. The interval is in between about a year or 12 months. So in the Erushin or stage one or part one, there's actually the signing of the marriage ketubah, okay? And it stipulates the mohar. Now, this word is so important, I would like to actually invite you to scribble it down. So anywhere you are, I would like you to write down the word mohar, okay? Just write it down, because it will come back again and again and again. So if you are there somewhere in the background, I'd like to actually just encourage you to write this word down, mohar, okay? Because that is a very, very important word that I'd like you to take note of. Praise God. So please write down the word mohar, because at some point tonight, that word will have to come back from, you have to retrieve that word from your memory, and it become like, aha, I get it. Okay, so praise God for that. Now let's go on. So we're still in phase one, part one, part of the whole overall concept called the Erushin. So the Kiddushin is a sanctification or betrothal, and this is involved the signing of the marriage ketubah, and it stipulates the mohar. So what is the mohar? In Genesis 34 verse 12, it talks about the mohar. It's usually 50 shekels. There's the bridegroom's obligation to provide in three key areas: food, clothing, and conjugal relation. It also ensures the wife's rights, security, and protection. And it also talks about the gift, Genesis 24, 53. So that's stage one, Erushin or Kiddushin, and involves generally the betrothal. So actually the bridegroom-to-be actually and his father will come to the house, and they actually involve in a signing ceremony. That's the ketubah, the signing of the marriage ketubah. So that's whole price of the signing of the marriage ketubah, which is a legal document. And then it involved the stipulation of the mohar, the gift, what the wife will actually get or receive in return to being the bride of the bridegroom. Because bear in mind, in ancient civilizations, both husband and wife, and that is a bit different, because some teachers actually highlight that the son is very important. So therefore, when the wife marry, you give the money to the wife, or the daughter is very important. So, you know, the father loses a daughter, so you give some mohar to the daughter. But I believe that both are important, but it is the duty of the bridegroom to provide the mohar. So that's part one. We're done with part one. So just bear with me, listen in, let it soak in and run through your mind and your spirit, man. Okay. Now part two. That's where it gets really exciting. Part two is where actually the actual wedding will take place, okay? Where the couple will start life together. So let's go on. So we talk about stage one, Kiddushin, which in essence, it's actually from the word kadosh. So now it begins to make sense. Most of you Christians or Sunday church goers will heard of the word kadosh, right? I'm sure some of you will be like, oh yeah, kadosh. Kadosh, kadosh. And you're like, oh, what's that? The song that's called holy, holy, holy. So the word kadosh, actually, that's the root word for kiddushin. So when the bridegroom and the father approach the bride for a certificate, for an engagement, that's called kiddushin. That is where sanctification or dedication is involved. Both of them are set apart for one another. That is a very important word. So I'd like to get you to get that word to sink into your mind. So the kiddushin or sanctification or dedication, it comes from the word kadosh. Alrighty? Anyone on the chat there? No? Cool. Thanks, Doris, Pastor Doris. So the next one, if we go on. So Erushin, being engaged, involved being under covenant. Turn to your neighbor and say, under covenant. I'm going to show you a very short clip later on. You may have seen it, you may have not, but it will change your perspective of wedding. Okay, being engaged involved being under covenant, each set apart for the other. Though remain under covenant, they live apart. Both remain a virgin. That's the reason why, if you notice, Joseph and Mary, Joseph was in cold sweat, like, kialama, because suddenly the wife like, hey, how come we are virgins? And then the wife actually is pregnant with child. you go like, 奇怪, 不可以的, 不可能. I just switched to Mandarin, Hokkien, and Hakka and everything. Okay, so how could that happen? So in the ancient Jewish wedding, souls are treated with respect. Men and women are treated with respect. Virginity is treated with respect. Okay, so next one. So basically, when you come about, though both are under covenant, they live apart and both remain a virgin. So the bridegroom will ride the horse and go back to his father's house. Those days, we don't have Tesla, yeah? No electric car. So remember the conundrum of Joseph and Miriam, which we talk about? Not Sister Miriam, but the one in the Bible, although Sister Miriam bears the same name, M-I-R-Y-A-M, right? But Luke 1:27, that's where you can find the conundrum, the story in the Bible. Luke 1:27, for those of you who want to study further. So although this is not the final conclusion, but you get the idea where this saying actually comes from in Songs of Solomon. I am my beloved's, and my beloved is mine. Ani ladodi wadodi li. Okay, I'd like to invite you to turn to your neighbor or talk to yourself, right? Say it together. Ani ladodi wadodi li. Okay, I am my beloved's, and my beloved is mine. That's actually taken from Song of Solomon, chapter 6, verse 1 to 4. That's why if you look at Luke 1:27, it says, it will betrothed to a maiden engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the maiden's name was Miriam. And Miriam says to the messenger, 奇怪,哪里可以了? Sorry, that's Mandarin. How shall this be? Since I do not know the man. So that's where you get a conundrum. So you can understand a sense, a flavor, a deep appreciation. That when that kiddushin or erusin, the part one of the ceremony takes place, both are set apart under covenant, but they live apart. And that is a very, very, very important point. It's so important. I want you to sink, let that thought sink into you. They were both together under a marriage covenant. Part one, ketubah, erusin, kiddushin. But then they move apart. There's a lot of deep spiritual truth. There's a lot of self-processing that needs to take place tonight. Welcome, Sister Louisa. I'll see you tomorrow, 3:30. Thank you so much for being with us. We love you. Let's continue. So stage one, erusin, the betrothal ceremony. Turn to your neighbor and say, the betrothal ceremony. You can actually look up 2 Samuel 3:14, Luke 1:27. And then we have the signing of the marriage ketubah. So the reason why I'm repeating this is because it's a new language to you, right? Imagine me coming from Malaysia, Singapore. When I came to Australia, I can't even change a light bulb. So, you know, when we call an electrician, they go, they speak. And when I answer the phone, I look as if like I'm the chicken behind my back. Yeah, because I don't understand anything. So tonight I'm actually intentionally exposing you and repeating some of this syllabus because quite a few of you are new. Okay, so that's the stage one, the engagement, the kiddushin, coming from the word kadosh, the erusin, the betrothal, and the signing of the marriage ketubah. Hayu, there we go. So that's the ketubah, the covenantal terms. So if you look at this, this is actually an ancient ketubah. The 13th century Rabbi Aharon Halevi adds a different version, say, of the logic behind this one covenant, we find that the Torah has commanded us to perform an act before taking a wife, a method that is intended to show there are a couple united in wedlock before he lies down with her carnally. Did you get it? That's the reason why the conundrum with Joseph and Mary, and that he come not upon her as one would do to a harlot, where there is no other act that precedes what goes on between them. It's a very serious document. And I want to stop here and expand on my teaching because this is not in the notes. But what I learned is that Joseph is a very honorable man. I think Sister Miriam picked up all this because she's very experienced in this Hebraic and Jewish, ancient Jewish wedding teaching. But Joseph was a very honorable man. He could have just discharged Mary and said, see you later, Mike. But no, he actually kept her. So these are actually some examples. They were found in caves, letters where the ketubah has been found. So these are actually real artifacts that we have of the practices of the ancient Jewish wedding. So stage one, as we mentioned, the erusin, the engagement, the kiddushin, what do we stipulate? The ketubah stipulates the moha, or the bridal price, Genesis 34:12. And it stipulates also the bridegroom's obligation to provide in three key areas, which is usually food, clothing, and conjugal relations. It also ensures the wife's rights, the security and protection. Okay? And it also talks about the gift. So something for the bride to remember when the groom is away. Can you see now, even before I go into part two, that actually there's something that's so similar to what Christ did. Remember, Christ talked about, let not your hearts be troubled. That's John. What is that found in? How many of you can remember that verse? Let not your hearts be troubled. What's that? That's found in John chapter 14. Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. So in other words, Christ, Yeshua, was actually referring to the bride and reassuring the bride. My gale, don't be afraid. Jangan takut, jangan khawatir. There may be COVID, there may be cocaine, there may be a pandemic, but I'm still with you. I will send the recording and I'll put it on Rumble and YouTube, brother Watchman Nathan. I'm still with you. What comforting assurance words to those pastors who preach from John 14 or Yohanan 14 who has never brought this insight to you. May I suggest to you tonight, actually, it's very deep what Christ has shared. Okay, so there we go. Let's continue. So basically, at the end of the day, that's the reason why the Holy Spirit is given to the church. When Christ went back to the Father to prepare a room, he actually released the gift to the church, the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. Praise God. So part two is the Nisuin. This is not the part two. This is just part one, but the second phase, or part 1B, okay, of the wedding ceremony, of the wedding. Okay, it's Nisuin. Turn to your neighbor and say Nisuin. The root word is actually Nasa. Okay? It's actually to be lifted up. It's from Strong's Hebrew 5:3-7:5. Okay? Those of you who like to write, you can actually write it like this. Okay? Nasa is actually Nun, Shin, and Aleph. Nasa. Okay? Very good. Now, very interestingly, Nasa is actually the word 5:3-7:5 is actually to lift up. Interesting. NASA is also NASA. You know, when the space shuttle program gets lifted up, that's from the NASA space shuttle program. NASA, from the word Nisuin. So the word Nisuin has a root word, and that word is NASA. Nun Shin Aleph, and that's in Strong's Hebrew 5:3-7:5. The Chinese have this custom too, to lift up, where the bride is being carried in a special sedan chair. Did you see that actually in our civilizations, we actually still have remnants of practices, of ancient practices, whether you are, I think there's some of us from a Catholic church here tonight, you know, whether you're from a Catholic background, from a European background, whether you're from a Chinese background, whether you're from an ancient Chinese background, or maybe Persian background, you know, there's a lot of these practices that are still remnants, residues of our rich past, but especially in the biblical ancient Jewish wedding. So that Chinese is the same, you know, they lift up the bride and they walked on and so on. So the bride is actually carried in a special sedan chair. You can see another photo here. So some of you have been to a Jewish wedding, even today in the 21st century. I was very blessed to actually go to a brother from Israel who migrated to Western Australia, who got married in a university ground, in the university grounds, you know, in the restaurant in the university grounds, because he was actually a university officer at that time, you know. And that was the first time we actually got to understand the hoopah, you know. I was not exposed to the Jewish wedding. I didn't realize the significance of the hoopah and other significance as well. But I was blessed to actually observe firsthand how it might look like the rich traditions of the ancient Jewish wedding. So the hoopah and the wedding ceremony. So when does the couple come under the hoopah? Is it during the erusin or the nidusin? There's a lot of definitions out there. But the word hoopah, it means covering or protection. And it acts as a symbolic roof covering the couple who are getting married. So I guess I will answer your question. When they come together, when they get married, it is where the legal business of betrothal takes place and symbolizes the home of the groom into which the bride is welcome. In a Jewish wedding ceremony, the bride and the groom stand under the hoopah as a symbol of the bridegroom's permanent and real home. And the bride in the Song of Solomon talk about being invited into a love's chambers. Ah, now you begin to understand some of the stuff that I read in the book of the Song of Solomon. No wonder being invited into her love's chambers, like a sukkah. It is a temporary shelter symbolizing a home where there is great rejoicing and intimate fellowship. So in Jewish weddings, as Sister Miriam has pointed out, that's why she chose to use the word festival rather than feast. Rejoicing is taken very seriously. So too with the Feast of Sukkot, and it's coming on Saturday. So please come and join us, okay? It is the only feast in which we are actually commanded to rejoice. Isn't that right? So this is a picture of the ancient wedding. You can see the sukkah over here. Can anyone see the sukkah? I just highlighted to you. That's the sukkah over here. So that's the sukkah. So the bride and the groom comes under the sukkah, and you know, and then there's a person who will marry them. So there we go. That's the sukkah. All right. So the sukkah actually come from the word hoopah. All right. A hoopah actually is a canopy or a chamber. Okay. Now, very interestingly, I'm going to show you a quick video now just to highlight what goes on under the hoopah. Sorry, just now I was talking about sukkah. It's not. It should be hoopah. Since this is a recording, I thought I'd just make it clear. Let's watch something that's very special that happens at the Nisuin. So first we have the engagement and now is the actual wedding. Ready? Let's go. Okay, usually at my teaching, it is at this juncture that I actually ask the audience, why do you think they break the glass? What is the significance of the breaking of the glass with the stamping of the feet? Someone like it? Brilliant. So anyone would like to put up your hands, unmute yourself, and perhaps share with us, what is the significance of breaking the glass? Anyone? What is the significance of breaking the glass? Can anyone tell us in your own words, what's the significance of breaking the glass? So by the way, this little clip is used for teaching purposes, and it's actually from the movie Fiddler on the Roof. It's an amazing movie.
It's a fantastic movie. It's a
fantastic
wonderful movie. Talks about the Jews, that time they were living in a community. And when the armed forces came, they had to vacate and leave the place. So it's actually a very sad movie. But that wedding is actually very beautiful. I don't understand the meaning, but I guess that once the cup is broken, that means that they have accomplished something to something to a new beginning or something like that. Yeah.
So I like
maybe
to
check. You could explain it better than me. Yeah.
So I like to check with our teacher. So teacher Miriam says breaking the glass signifies remembering the destruction of the temple. What about in the wedding, Sister Miriam, teacher Miriam? What does this signify in the wedding when the couple breaks the glass? Oh, you need to unmute. Sorry. Charitie, can you kindly unmute Sister Miriam, please? Thank you. Hold on. There we go. All right. Now we can hear you, Sister Miriam.
Yes, I just know it as tradition in remembrance of the destruction of the temple.
Ah, okay.
Do you know any other? Do you know any other way? Or
I was thinking, actually, the breaking of the glass signifies the complete union of the couple.
Could be.
And a breaking away from her father's house.
Breaking away from the father's house, you know, it signifies that once we are in this journey together, is, you know, we just want to stay together and stick together. So I guess, but it's a very symbolic thing, isn't it, to actually look at, you know, there's a deep meaning to that as well. So thank you very much for sharing. So now let's continue. So that's the breaking of the glass. So in Jewish weddings, rejoicing is taken very seriously. So too with the feast and the festival of Sukkot. You know, it is also the time of the year when we build a tent, erect a sukkah, and we come together and we rejoice. We are commanded to rejoice. So this coming Saturday on the 8th of October, we're actually celebrating the festival or the Feast of Tabernacle, or what we call Sukkot. All right, so we're going to do that at the church hall in Livestream Christian Church at the back, at the Discovery Cove Hall at the back. And we start from 2 o'clock, but you can come from 12:30 to help us to set up the place. And please bring a dish, you know, we'll give more announcements at the end of this teaching. But if you look at it deeper, the three stages of Isaac's marriage to Rebecca is also talked about in the Bible. If you look at it from stage one, actually you have Genesis chapter 24, you talk about stage one. An offer of marriage is proposed. The offer is accepted. And marriage, Rebecca is married by contract. Gift and money are given to both the bride and the parents of the bride. Notice that Rebecca was asked if she consented to the marriage. So both have to accept. Next is the consummation, stage two. Rebecca and Isaac went into the tent. So I guess before they go into the tent and they break the glass. So breaking of the glass signifies that once we enter into the tent, none of us are together. It's like, you know, that's my conjecture. It's like, you know, this is a done deal. This is it. We're in it together for life. Celebration is the stage three, not mention of the wedding feast, but one that likely happened. If you do a deeper study, the three stages of Jacob's marriage to Leah is the same. And the three stages of Jacob's marriage to Rachel, Genesis 29. So at this stage, I just thought, I had actually a aha moment in my mind. Do you have an aha moment in your mind? Look at it. Jacob married how many people? First, he married Leah after working for 7 years, and then he married Rachel. Could it be, if you look at it deeply, that actually, can you see the connections? Does anyone have an aha moment like me? Like you married one for the first 7 years and then you married the second one. One is actually the elder and one is actually the younger. Or one is the younger and then you're the elder. What is it, the other way around? I don't know. I'll leave it to you to think and conjecture, all right? But so those three stages of marriages is actually elaborated in different passages in the Bible. That's the point I'm trying to highlight. So that's the end of part one. It's nice and easy. And we just into end of part one. So I'm just going to continue. If we can. So that's the end of part one. All right. Now, part two is the refocus. So now we're actually going to refocus from the ancient Jewish wedding to Yeshua and the bride. Okay. Get ready. Okay. That's where it gets exciting. Hosea 2:19. You may want to write this down. This is a very powerful Bible verse. It says, I will betroth you to me forever. Yes, I will betroth you to me in righteousness, in justice, in grace, and in compassion. Okay. So, you know, and what does this talk? Speaks to you about the bridal price has been paid, the moha. Remember, I mentioned to you to actually write down the word moha just now. You know, write down somewhere on your word moha, so you can see that actually when Christ died on the cross, he actually paid the price, the ultimate price, and that price is the likened to the moha. Isn't that correct? Okay, so. Very good. Someone have talked about this and that. So at the end of the day, the bridal price has been paid by Christ. It's called the moha. Very good. And through the death of Yeshua, that bridal price has been paid. If you look at it from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 and 19, it says, you should be aware that the ransom paid to free you from the worthless way of life, which your fathers passed on to you, did not consist of anything perishable, like silver or gold, On the contrary, it was the costly, bloody, sacrificial death of the Messiah, as of a lamb without defect or spot. So through his death on the cross, we are engaged to him. We are betrothed to Yeshua, to Christ. 1 Corinthians 6:19 and 20 says, "Or don't you know that your body is a temple for the Ruach HaKodesh, who live inside you, whom you receive from God? The fact is, you do not belong to yourself, for you were bought at a price." What price is that? The price, the moha. So use your bodies to glorify God. Isn't that amazing? So again and again, you can see there's parallel between what is going on in the ancient Jewish wedding of Kiddushin, Erusin, Nisuin, and the plan of salvation of God. You can see, you know, the bridal price. Now you can see, that's the moha. Isn't that amazing? The deep truth that God, our creator, our savior, our Abba Father, has taught us through human wedding ceremonies. Some of you who are my biblical students, you would know God has his signatures everywhere. In the Moedim, in the seventh feast, in the appointed times, you know, the Passover, the feast first fruits, the unleavened bread, the Shavuot, you know, and the we just celebrated the Yom Teruah, the Yom Kippur yesterday, you know, and the coming Feast of Tabernacle. That feast is also an ancient signature of God. It doesn't just apply to the Jewish people. It's for the church. It's for everyone. We come together as one. Ephesians 2:15. Some of you would know about the signature in our DNA. You know, in the DNA of the human DNA, every 10 bridge, every 5 bridge, every 10 bridge, every 10 connections, there's a bridge. Every 5 connection, there's a bridge. Every 6 connection in the DNA, there's the helix DNA cycle, there is a bridge, and every 5. So if you look at the word 10, 5, 6, 5, that's Yud, Hey, Wav, Hey, by the way. So God, like an artist of the highest excellence, has actually dropped his signature in everything that we may not even be aware of in life. Sister Miriam will tell you about colors in the Bible. Blue and brown and red becomes brown and stuff like that. You know, so the Bible is amazing. God has used all these lessons to remind us again and again. So today we're just talking about 1 Corinthians 6:19 and 20. And regarding this moha price, he paid in full. Remember, it says it is finished. It's John chapter 19, verse 30. It is finished. Turn to your neighbor and say, Tatalasai. Tatalasai. Apparently, Tatalasai is like this. If I commit something wrong, or someone who stole billions of dollars goes to jail, comes out 10 years, 7 years later, I don't know when he or she will come out from jail after stealing so many billions of dollars from the country. But, you know, imagine in ancient time, if someone goes to jail, you know, and comes out from jail, at the door, at the prison gate, when the person is about to take his little coarse plastic bag with all his clothing and his change that he has accumulated throughout his working career in the prison, the prison officer will hand him a note and say, Tatalasai. It means it is finished. Your sentence, you have served it in full. On a humorous side, it is finished. It's like this, you know, if I and Charitie quarrel, right? And I can't give an explanation, it is finished. Just kidding. All right. But you get the seriousness of it, that it is finished. It's actually like completely, completely, completely paid the price. So regarding the moha price, Christ, Yeshua, the bridegroom, he paid it in full. John chapter 19, verse 30. Okay, so next, betrothed and moha fully paid. The kala and the hatan has now entered into a covenant relationship. So I want to introduce you a new word, the kala and the hatan. Hold that in mind, okay? The kala and the hatan, okay? Thank you very much for your feedback. Tonight is a serious teaching. I'm just trying to make it engaging, but it's a very, very serious teaching. You can listen to this 3, 5, 10 times, improve upon what I teach you, but the Holy Spirit will teach you what you need to know. Betrothed and fully paid, the kala and the hatan has now entered into a covenant relationship. We are now set apart. Remember, we talk about the word kiddushin, means holy, kadosh unto the Lord. We are set apart. So that's the reason why I'm going to go into a lot of things later on. I'm going to talk about this. So look at this in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6. I want the audience now to actually sit down and work with me. Okay, let's articulate this together. Okay, this is the word for your holy people unto me, says Yahweh. Okay, let's say it together. Key means, for means key. Say key. Am means people. Say am. And this is a word for holy. It means kadosh. Okay? So let's say it together. Ki am kadosh. Ata Yahweh. Eloheka beka baha Yahweh. Eloheka liyot lo le'am. Segula. Micho ha'amim ashe al penei ha'adama. What he's trying to highlight here is that you are a holy people unto Yahweh, unto the Lord. In Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6. And that is very, very important. So spreading the skirt on your cloak, spreading your, spreading your wing of protection over your maidservant. Ruth chapter 3, verse 9. And Ezekiel chapter 16, verse 8 says, I will spread my skirt over you and cover your nakedness. I also swore to you and entered into a covenant with you so that you became mine, declares the Lord. You see how the entire Bible is actually a legal document. Have you seen this before? Has anyone highlighted to you that the entire Bible is actually a legal document? It's not a love story. It's actually a legal document. God is a very honorable God. What he says he will do. Sometimes today when you look at Facebook Messenger and you want to sell some chickens or some secondhand goods, and 10 people will say, yeah, I'll come and pick it up at 2 o'clock. They never come. Right? Very fickle-minded. But God is not like that. What he says he will do. Even if it takes him 2,000, 4,000, 6,000 years, he will say, when he says something, he will do it. He makes sure that he will actually honor his word. Okay, and that's the meaning of spreading the skirt over you, covering your nakedness, swearing to you, entering into a covenant with you so that you became mine, declares the Lord. So God as Israel's husband, Jeremiah 31, 22, Isaiah 2, 19, Isaiah 54, 5, Jeremiah 2, 2, and 3, 14. Now, this is conjecture, but the reason why I think that Jacob married Leah and Rachel is because God entered into a covenant with Israel. Well, they ditched him and they didn't realize the Savior. So actually God entered into a covenant with the church, right? So this is my conjecture. So actually, you know, now the two has become one, isn't that? So that's something that I see. So what about the ketubah, the marriage covenant? In the Old Testament, it was when Moses took the Torah, written on a stone, the legal and moral commitment for the Jews. Psalms 89, 34. I shall not profane my covenant. Now, in the New Testament, in Pentecost, it's both Jews and Gentiles grafted in. Now, get this. This is so beautiful. The Ten Commandments is written in our heart. Jeremiah 31, verse 33. Again, it says in Hebrews 10, 16. This is the covenant. Covenant is breathed in Hebrew. I will make with them after that day, says the Lord. After that time, says the Lord. I will put my laws, my Torah in their heart, in the Levav, and I will write them, kataf them, on their minds. So the bridegroom has paid the price. And we remember while he was still there, he said, in the same way also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the renewed covenant in my blood. As often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the master until he comes. And he said to them, this is my blood of the covenant, which is being poured out on behalf of many. Truly, I say to you that never again am I drinking from the fruit of the wine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. Mark chapter 14, verse 24 and 25. I'll read to you another Bible verse and then I'll explain. Matthew 26, 29 says, I tell you, I will not drink this fruit of the wine again until the day I drink new wine with you in my Father's kingdom. I'm sure we all remember the four cups of Passover. How many of you remember the four cups of Passover? Put up your hands. Anyone remember the four cups of Passover? Of course, we all remember the four cups. Zoom user. Right, sister, teacher, everyone here, Joyce, yes. My question to you is, did Yeshua finish drinking the four cups with the disciples? Let's look at the chat answers. So this is not a trick question. Did Yeshua actually complete the four cups with the disciples? Yes or no? Sister Joyce, bravely. Not yet. No. No. Okay, we got three answers. No. Anyone dares to be different? Come on. And Carol just now said, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Thank you. Joyce says no. Christine says not yet. Carol says no. Siu Yong says no. So I gather that you get the gist. There's 184 people here. 6% get the gist. Very good. So let me just, I'm sure there are many of you who get the gist, but I'm trying to type on the little chat button. But I'm sure you all remember the four cups of Pesach Passover, you know. And those of you who have been to a Messianic congregation like us in Taft Ministries in Perth or other Messianic congregations, or those of you have gone to Israel to celebrate the Passover right here in the land of Israel, you know, you remember the four cups signifies, I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians, cup one. I will rescue you from slavery, cup two. I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment, cup number three. Tisa, I will take you as my own people and I will be your God, number four, right? So now the question is, again, I ask you, one cup when Yeshua was here on earth, another cup, the marriage supper of the Lamb. So I guess if you look at it from the Bible, it says the third cup of the wine is the cup of redemption. And that's what Christ did. He redeemed us. He paid in full on the cross, the Moha. This is where Christ announced the new covenant for forgiveness of sins. Luke 22, 20 and Matthew 26, 27, 28. He did not drink the fourth cup of the wine, the cup of completion. He says that he will drink that cup with us in heaven, Matthew 26, 29, at the marriage supper of the Lamb. So now you actually begin to understand. Okay, so again, I just come back to you. There are four cups in Passover. I will bring you out. Cup one, I'll rescue you from slavery. Cup two, I'll redeem you. Cup three, with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. And I will take you as my own people and I'll be your God. All these are referenced to Exodus chapter 6, verse 6 and 7. The point I'm making is that Christ actually drank three cups. Okay? So on earth, Christ took the first cup, the second cup, and the third cup. The final cup is reserved for the marriage supper of the Lamb. Again, I iterate, the third cup of wine is the cup of redemption. This is where Christ announced the new covenant for forgiveness of sins. Okay, so this is very important. So important, I'm going to highlight to you. The third cup is the cup of redemption. This is where Christ announced the new covenant for the forgiveness of sins. He did not drink the fourth cup of wine, the cup of completion. He said that he will drink that cup with us in heaven, at the marriage supper of the Lamb. So important. Let's turn our Bibles to Matthew. Let's look into our Bible. Good old way. Turn to your Bible now. Matthew 26, verse 29. Matthew chapter 26, verse 29. What does it say? Does anyone want to read for us? Matthew chapter 26, verse 29. Turn to your Bible. Matthew chapter 26. No smartphone, nothing. A real Bible, okay? Real good Bible. Matthew chapter 26, verse 29. Can someone unmute yourself and read for us loud and clear? Matthew chapter 26, verse 29. Now you begin to appreciate and understand the words of Yeshua in red.
I tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.
Isn't that amazing? We've read it 1,000 times. Wow. And Sister Miriam says, I'll redeem you with an outstretched arm. Yeshua's arm was outstretched on the cross when he was in the act of redeeming mankind. And again, you can see that in Yud Hey Wav Hey. Behold the hands, behold the nails. Even God's name, embedded in God's name is that message. My son, behold his hands, behold his nails on the cross. Thank you, teacher Miriam. So at the end of the day, this is something that is very, very important. There are four cups But Christ did not complete the four cups. He's waiting for us. He's coming back. So the Kala and the Hatan, the bride and the groom, has entered into a covenant relationship. And that's the reason why I started by alluding to and referring to John, Yohanan 15, 1 and 2. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. Remember, after the engagement ceremony, or the betrothal ceremony, or the ketubah signing, the groom actually goes back to the father's house and prepare everything that the bride needs. You know, prepare new plumbing, new room, new aircon, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, selfie, iPhone, just kidding, right? So those stuff that the bride would need, okay? At the end of the day, that is what Christ is meaning in John 15, 1 and 2. Interesting, isn't it? So with an assurance of his return, what should the bride do? Return to her Facebook page for another selfie, grow some vegetables, eat some bugs. You will own nothing and be happy, yeah? Set up an Instagram account, worry about what to eat and drink. Get your char kway teow. Yeah, where to drink char kway teow tomorrow? I'm tired. Get some Botox to beautify yourself. No, 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 no. So the Bible says, Matthew 6, 28, 30, why you worry? Why you worry? Just kidding. So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I say to you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. So if God clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, or you of little faith? Again, it's a very, very interesting language there. Assurance of a bridegroom to a bride. It is therefore the duty of the bride to prepare and get herself ready. Okay? Turn to your neighbor and say, prepare. Prepare and get yourself ready. Barbara got it. He said, be ready to receive the bridegroom. So this is where you need to take in a cup of coffee or double shot cappuccino or teh tarik, kuat kuat. So this is where the teaching gets very interesting. I'm going to share with you a few things that are out of the ordinary. Okay? It's not non-biblical. It's just very strong coffee. Well, the bridegroom is a way to prepare a place for her. Remember the parable of the 10 virgins. 5 were wise, 5 were foolish. Oil was the decisive factor in securing entry into the wedding feast. Therefore, prepare and watch. Preparation, my dear brothers and sisters, is a personal mandate. You can say my grandfather is a Schindler, the guy who made the sign for 3,000 people to escape Schindler's List. Or my grandfather is the Chiyo Sugihara, the guy who signed 5,000 visas for the Jews to escape to Japan or China. No, no, no. Salvation is, God has no grandchildren when it comes to salvation. You have to prepare. It's an exam. This life is a exam. This life is a test. Malay say cobaan. This life is a test. There are trials and temptations where we must go through the hurdles. Amen. So this life is a life of preparation. Not only do we have the washing of the word, the Torah and the Brit Hadashah, we have the Holy Spirit. Now, this is very interesting. If you look at the book of Esther, it says Esther's preparation by Haggai, 6 months of oil of myrrh for purification, Esther 2:12, and 6 months of sweet oil for beautification, Esther 2:12. Today, the bride is hidden in Christ, Yeshua, Colossians 3:3. So preparation is important because in Revelation, it says, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come and his wife has made herself ready. So in light of the bridegroom's soon return, now you begin to see and join together and you begin to stitch together some of the ancient Jewish wedding practices and some of the things that are written, the deep things of God that are written in the Bible. You go like, bridal price, moha, Christ died on the cross. Yud hei vav hei, behold the hand and the nail. Christ outstretched arms, buying the full price for mankind's salvation. Wow. Kiddushin kadosh, being set apart. The one that the Bible keeps talking about and highlighting and repeating and emphasizing, you and I are set apart. So guys, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, dear believers in the kingdom of God, regardless whether you're Christian or Catholics, Seventh-day Adventists or whatever, in light of the bridegroom's soon return, how do you see yourself? As a servant? As a guest? Or as a bride-to-be? My dear brothers and sisters, this is very, very important. He's not coming back for a child bride. He's not coming back for a childish bride. Contamination is not fully. He's not coming back for a contaminated bride and full of ego. He's not coming back for an immature bride that's got worldly values. Christ, a friend of mine said this, and we're discussing the other day. He said, Christ is returning for his bride, not a concubine. Right? If you are a bride, you prepare yourself. If you are a concubine, you look pretty. Waiting for the general from whatever, or coming, hello, how are you? Come back in the next 10 years to sleep with another concubine. No. Being a bride has its role and its place, and being a bride means you have to prepare yourself. Okay, so Christ is not coming back for his bride. He's not coming back. So I just want to highlight this. I think this is from a Catholic priest. It says, our characters and value matters, the seven deadly sins. How many of you are familiar with this list? Lust, gluttony, greed, sloth, wrath, envy, and pride. Put up your hands. The seven modern deadly sins. Anyone? Put up your hands. How many of you are familiar with the seven modern deadly sins? Very good. Quite a few of you. All right, Barbara, Carol, Joyce, Charitie, everyone. How many of you are familiar? Yeah, quite a few of you here. So have you heard of this list called the seven deadly sins? Lust, gluttony, greed, sloth, wrath, envy, and pride. By the way, I intentionally not eat dinner today because I had a very rough day yesterday. I had three major medical conferences. I came back. I finished my work. I slept at one. I had to wake up early today to do more webinars on Zoom with my colleagues in Sydney. And then I say, Lord, I got to prepare myself. So God gave me an opportunity to have a little snooze before tonight's meeting. And I look at the food, look at me, and I said, no, Lord, not tonight, not on my shift. I'm going to conquer my tummy. I'm going to conquer my appetite because I just want to be hyper-focused for the Lord. I'm sure that I'm not a good example because some of you watchmen, like Brother Nathan, I'm sure you can fast for many, many days. And so on, yeah. But at the end of the day, it's not just about these seven deadly sins. There's much more. Okay, I want you to take a look at this video over here. The point is, it's not just about our seven deadly sins of lust, gluttony, greed, sloth, anger, envy, and pride. And those of you who attended Brother Reggie's list about the multimedia deception, he showed a video at the end of his conclusion of part three where the video of a lady's house was fully trashed. All because she took away the son's mobile phone. And the son became so angry, trashed the entire house. Even the toilet bowl was broken into two. You saw that, right? That stuck to my memory for a couple of days. But if you look at it, at the end of the day, what we are told to do is like this. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound familiar? Christ says, forgive 7 times, 7 times, 490 times. It's like sometimes we got a bad habit and we go back to the bad habit and repeat the same mistakes all over again. Just like life gives us a test. We're supposed to pass the test. Cobaan itu datang. Kita sepatutnya pass, right? I'm speaking in Malay now, right? But instead of passing, we go back to the same thing again and again and again. You know, where is our transformation? I think tonight we need to do communion. Charity, prepare communion. So, you know, those of you who are, you know, have turned your cameras off, get your bread ready and your wine ready. Let's do communion. Let's do service with the word of God. It's not just a cognitive teaching, but we need to do business with God tonight, including myself, the teacher, right? So now, this is very important. Although this is for my biblical Hebrew students, I want to, it's a reminder for those who have come to my classes. It's a new teaching for those of you who are not biblical Hebrew students. The word for knowledge is da'at. The root word is yada. Turn to your neighbor and say yada. Not the yada, 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 yada. No, it means yada. It means to know. Okay? Yada is not just an information dump. The same word yada, to know, is used when Cain knew his wife. So what does that tell you? Knowing is not a cognitive exercise. too often in the Western civilizations, whether it's the Western church in Australia or, you know, even third generation Chinese Christians or whatever, you know, we lost touch with God. We connect for 1 hour on Sunday and the rest of the day we are so busy. In fact, the blessing is actually, like Sister Miriam says, if you're a teacher, it's good. First, you've got a heavier responsibility because you're a teacher. Whatever you say that is wrong, God will judge you double. But the other thing on the flip side of the coin, if you're a teacher and you teach a good word of the Lord, you actually am blessed because through the research process of learning the word of God, you begin to understand the Father's heartbeat in a deeper way. Amen. You begin to understand God. I'm truly in awe of you. I'm truly in love in all of you. The things that you have shared with us through nature, through the word of God, through everything, through ancient Jewish wedding. So to know is not just a cognitive knowing or a cerebral knowing or just a brain knowledge dump, not just an information dump. To know is actually intimate. In fact, did you know it's so serious? Two different words are used in the New Testament when it refers to a son. One word is technon, and the second word is huion. So the word technon, I'm not a biblical Hebrew, a Greek scholar, but I can teach biblical Hebrew, but I can understand technon and huion are different, spelled differently. So the question here is this, and the commentary here, and the challenge here is this, my dear brothers and sisters, we all aspire to wear. There's spelling mistakes here. So let me just try to go back here. We all aspire to wear. Let me just correct the spelling mistake because I do not want to make an error. Okay, there we go. Let's try that again. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Share. There we go. So we all aspire to wear the coat of many colors like Joseph. But did you know that Joseph has to endure 13 years of training and discipline? So my dear brothers and sisters, I believe you remember in the Bible, it says, consider it all beautiful when God brings you through many trials and tribulations. Apostle Paul has to endure many of these trials and tribulations. Moses has to endure the constant, incessant whinging and whining. I shared this story before. Did you know why the Lord actually give the Israelites quails? Remember the Israelites complaining, here got no chakwetia. I mean, here got no meat to eat. Back in the days of Egypt, you know, we had lots of meat. We have meat to our armpit. We have meat in the freezer, in the oven. But then here, you cause us to die, la. Yeah. No meat to eat. Why like that, la? Complaining, whinging, whining. Australian call it whingers and whiners, right? W&W. Very interesting. Oh, God, Doris said, God gave them mana. Mana actually comes from the word mean. It means something that when the water dries, something comes out. The coriander seed. Something that, yeah. So mana, there's actually a meaning when they read the word mana. That's a side lesson. Let's come back. So, but then God gave them what? God sent them quails. And I said, God, why quails? Recently, I think I know the answer. I brought a few quails home. And this quail seller called me. He says, yeah, everything is female. So I bought 5-10 quails home. And most of them were male quails. Oh my good. Pastor Ozzy, you would know this, right? Male quails make noises. Every morning, every evening, every night is like a prayer unto the quails, the female quails. Kraw, 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 kraw. And my neighbor got so upset. They say, hey, Brother Dave, he's not a Christian, right? He's not a believer. He says, what's that exotic bird at your backyard? I go like, I do not know. I think I lied. I say, oh, I'm so sorry. And I'm just trying to get it under control. So we actually have to sell all our male quails and transfer the problem to a lady. But we did alert her. These are male quails. They are very noisy. Are you prepared? And she says, 没问题,可以,给我,我要卖你的quail. Oh, very good. So we sold our quail for $13.99 or $13.01 minus all the transaction fee. But the point I'm trying to highlight to you is this. I think God has a sense of humor. The Israelites were complaining and whinging and talking about the days of having beefsteaks and throw another shrimp on the barbecue. And God gave them mana. Mana, wake up. Boja. Mana no good. I want meat. Okay, God said, nah. Blow from the sea, the ocean, give you some quails. and come along with a quail, not just female quails, but male quails that make a lot of noises. And Moses go, God, you really do have a sense of humor, don't you? Like, you know, these people are whingers and whiners, and here you're sending the quails. Yeah, God didn't send the buffalo, the elephant, the beef stick, not the prawns, because Seventh-day Adventists and Jewish don't eat prawns, but God sent the quails. There is a point to this story. There is much ample points to this story, right? Let's go back to the screen. We all aspire to wear the coat of many colors like Joseph. But did you know Joseph had to endure 13 years of training and discipline? Like Moses, he had to endure the whinging and the whining, the incessant complaints of the Israelites until his father-in-law says, you'll be having no hair very soon, Moses. So he says, you've got to set leaders and subgroup, just like the church today has structure. Cell group leaders, zone group, cell group leaders, and so on. You know, but the training is very important. Those of you who have listened to my last Covenant Chesed and the Coming Bridegroom, these are new materials. These are my research and development that I put into this. Did you realize, or do you remember, there are 7 spiritual enemies? How many of you remember the 7 spiritual enemies? How many of you actually remember the 7 enemies of Israel? Put up your hand. Our teachers say there's the Mozzie bite, there's the Vegemite. Sister Joyce, remember, okay, you're being a good student and a good eagle. Name the 7 enemies of Israel in one breath. I'm just kidding. Would you like to do that? Let's try. Let's do it together. I may not get it right. Come on, let's do it together. What are the 7 enemies of Israel? The Canaanites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hittites, the Hivites, the Jebusites, the Parasites, the Vegemites. Just kidding, right? But you get the drift. There are 7 enemies of Israel. Oh, by the way, you know, these 7 enemies of Israel is very interesting. So the 7 enemies of Israel in the Promised Land, and you can read about this in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 1 to 13. My question to you tonight, dear brothers and sisters, is, ever wondered why Yahweh did not purge the ites from the Promised Land? Why? You got the Jebusites, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Girgashites. That's the one that we missed. The Girgashites and the Hivites. Why did God allow the enemies? I mean, it defies common sense, right? If I'm God, if I'm a good father like Pastor Ozzy or Pastor Daniel, or if I'm a good grandmother like Carol, or if I'm a good grandma like Barbara, at the end of the day, you would say, well, if I'm going to give a gift to my grandchildren or my children, I'm going to make sure that there's no nastiness to or sting to the gift. Isn't that correct? But why did God allow these 7 spiritual enemies to be with the Israelites? Why? Why did God allow? I take your point, Stephen. I'm just going to go through. Don't worry. These slides will be on, you know, on the video sharing and recording. Why did God not purge the ites from the Promised Land? Why? By the way, these 7 enemies are real. Okay, the Amorites is there. The Canaanites is there, the Hivite, the Perizzite, and the Jebusites, they're all there, the Hittites, and so on. So why? The answer is in Judges chapter 3, verse 1. It says, now these are the nations which the Lord left to prove Israel by them, even as many of the Israel has not known all the wars in Canaan. Did you get it? Now, these are the nations which the Lord left to prove Israel by them, even as many of Israel has not known all the wars in Canaan. Those of you from Asia, this quote or quotation is familiar to you. Riches does not retain in the family. It's not retained in the family for 3 generations. Why? The first generation, the father roll up the sleeve, go and make $3 million, $10 million, $20 million. And the children becomes complacent. Because the next generation, born with a silver spoon, everything is provided for. Even caviar is drop feed from the little faucet, right? You got domestic helpers to polish their fingernails, wash the cars, one to cook, one to put on their socks, right? Then the third generation, things continue to decay. Well, I think God the Father has the same thinking. You know, if he's going to just allow the Israelites to live that utopia or the shalom life with no enemies, guess what will happen to you and I? You know, the greatest period of success of the church is not when we have Tesla or Facebook or Instagram, look at me, 10 million views. No. The greatest time of success of the church is when there are martyrs, people are killed all over. That's right, Sister Barbara. When people are persecuted. So for Israel to be a surrounding nations, for Israel to be an example to the surrounding nations, and for them to realize what God's people has to go through is what Sister Louisa said. Thank you for your comments. So in other words, our Heavenly Father thinks that we are a worthy bride. Worthy bride. And therefore, we are worthy of trials and temptations. There is a Seventh-day Adventist song, or a song sung by the Seventh-day Adventist when I was young. And it goes like this. And I thank you, Lord, for the trials that comes my way, da-da-da, I can grow each day, da-da-da-da-da, and I thank you, Lord. And then it goes on and say, but it goes against the way I am to put my human nature on and let the Spirit of the Lord and take control. The hardest bit, the easiest bit is to run from one teaching to another. Why, hang on. And then five teachings this week, eh? The hardest bit is when God points out your inadequacy and say, hey, brother, sister, my dear son, my dear daughter, there's a pimple here. You need to do surgery on the pimple to remove it. Amen. So God, as the Father, brings us to disciplines and times of trials and tribulations, not to punish us, not to tear us down, but like Sister Louisa and Barbara and Carol and everyone has said, to test us. It's almost like in Singapore, they actually have this thing called national service. It's the same in Israel. Men and women go to national service in Israel. I think in Singapore, it's only the men, the male. But you know, when you go through national service, you learn to toughen up. Otherwise, you go like, my fingernail broken. Oh, fingernail broken, already crying, you know. I've got post-traumatic stress disorder. Why? The psychiatrist asked, or the psychologist asked, the clinical psychologist, I broke my fingernail yesterday. And my Instagram today, I only got 4 million likes. Yesterday, my TikTok got 10 million views. Are you very sad, huh? Wow, very good trial and tribulation. Judges chapter 3, verse 1 and 2. I highly recommend you to go back and read different versions of Judges 3, 1 and 2. I believe that this version is not the best, but you get the drift. Warning. And this is to encapsulate and condense everything that Louisa, Barbara, and Carol, and Miriam has just said. If you do not drive out the inhabitants of the land from before you, then it shall be that those whom you let remain shall be your irritants in your eyes. They will kakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakakak Numbers 33, verse 30, 55. I read it again. If you don't drive them out and you let them remain, they shall be irritants in your eyes and thorns in your sight, and they shall harass you, catch out you in the land where you dwell. I like to draw parallel, and I try to find in YouTube, on YouTube and Rumble, some of these spiritual parallels. Only very few videos exist. So I actually spent a few hours to look at this, the parallel between the physical enemies of Israel and the spiritual enemies we need to overcome. This is new material. Okay, there are very few people that teach about this. The Hittites, if you notice in Numbers 13:29, Deuteronomy 7:9, 1 and Judges 3:5, The actual enemy, the physical enemy, is the Hittites. Well, sorry, let me go up again. Well, the other enemy is actually the spiritual enemy, is fear, confusion, terror, discouragement. So you got a physical enemy, which are the Hittites. The spiritual enemy, the parallel spiritual enemy, is actually that we need to overcome is the fear, the confusion, the terror, and the discouragement. I just take a note here. Remember when Moses sent the 12 spies? 10 came back with a negative report. This being very fearful and terrorized by the giants in the land they spy. Cannot lah. Those people bigger than my biceps. Wow, their bicep bigger than my thigh. How to fight? So the Hittites will cause you fear and confusion. If you look at the natural world in today, you'll be very fearful. Klaus Schwab and his morons are trying to push us into the Great Reset. You will own nothing and be happy. But we need to focus our eyes on the great return of Yeshua. Amen? Who do you want to be? Who do you want to be? Do you want to be the 10 spies? Or do you want to be the two brave ones, Joshua? And who else, the other one? Joshua and? Who's the other one? Joshua and? Aaron, that's right. It's very important. Who do you want to be? On whom do you trust, put your trust? Joshua and Caleb, sorry, not Aaron. Joshua and Caleb, yeah. Caleb means a dog. Caleb, a dog. Yehoshua, Joshua, yeah, is also a Hebrew word. So who do you want to be? The 10 spies who came back paralyzed by fear with cold sweat and diapers are fully wet? Or do you want to be the two, exemplary Joshua and Caleb? Yeah. So these are the Hittites. Their weapons are fear, discouragement, confusion, and discouragement. Let's look at the next one, Gigashites. Now, Gigashite is found in Joshua 3, 9, 10, and Judges 3, 5. A willful turning away from God. A fickle-mindedness, unstable, clay-like, clay-ish. A backsliding spirit, causing self and others to stumble and lukewarm. This is very, very dangerous. Okay, this is very, very dangerous. So they got this willful, fickle, unstable mindset. I think the important thing here is to understand the importance of Teshuva. You can find these references here in Isaiah, Psalms, Judges, Hosea, and Jeremiah. I shall not repeat them. By the way, the word Teshuva is something very special. Teshuva is written with Tav, Shin, Vav, Bet, and He. It means returning unto God. Full return. No surrender. It comes from the root Hebrew word shuv, S-H-U-V, or H-U-B, okay? Shin Bet. Gigasites is a willful turning away from God. You know, sometimes I see Christians, we used to want to baptize a guy, that was about 20, 30 years ago. Every time we invite him to get baptized, or extend an invitation for him to get baptized, say, "Aiyah, not today lah, tomorrow." You know, and on the day of baptism, guess what happened? So this guy was like, every time you say, "Come, let's get baptized," or "Tomorrow, tomorrow." But tomorrow never comes. And the day of baptism, you know, back then I was in a different church. You know, before we started this Hebraic ministry, Messianic ministry. On the day of baptism, he actually chickened out, didn't come. So, you know, it's the fickle-mindedness. We need to say yes to Christ, and yes means yes. The next is the Amorites. Now, Amorites has a different kind of parallel. Amorites, you can find them in Numbers 13, 29, Deuteronomy 7, and Judges 3, 5. The actual enemy is the Amorites. The spiritual enemy is pride and arrogance. I can tell you one of the biggest enemy is not without the church. It's within the church, from all layers of leadership until the janitor and the person who sweeps the floor in the church. is ego and pride and the spirit of offense. You ask yourself, let's ask ourselves this question. Those of you from Australia to Hong Kong to Japan, anywhere, have you seen people coming in and out of churches like a musical chair moving from one church to another? They don't like church A because the pastor's nose hair is long. Second, the armpit is smelly. The third one, he say a different word. I get offended, you know. The pastor didn't acknowledge me when I come. Hello, pastor. He didn't look me in the eye. Oh, I'm a big shot. I contribute $5,000 a month to the church. How come he never looked me in the eye? I'm very offended. Eh? So I moved to another church. Correct? There's the spirit of pride, ego, easily offended. I think that's very sad. Very, very sad. The next one. Let's go to the next one. The final one is Canaanites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. So if you look at the Canaanites, it's actually greed. Why do I say that? Because they enjoy the accumulation of material wealth and earthly riches. How many of you remember Christ's words? How many of you remember Christ's words? Remember, there was a Bible text, Christ says, the rich man was saying, it's good. Tonight, I'm going to build this mansion. I'm going to buy that car, do that stock market. I'm sure when you watch YouTube videos, you know, at the beginning of the 10 minute, the first 10 seconds is always very irritating, right? You got somebody says, you have not made enough money in the stock market or cryptocurrency. I'm here to teach you to make tomorrow some money so tomorrow you don't have to work ever again. We all have this tendency to be greedy for accumulation, more than enough. What does James chapter 4 verse 4 say? What does James chapter 4 verse 4 say? This is a very interesting verse. Let's read it together. I think this is very important. It says, adulterers and adulteresses, did you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. So we need to remember ourselves that yes, we are of the world. We are in the world, but we are not of the world. We have two masters, and that is now this is controversial, okay? Not controversial, but don't take me in the wrong context. If we work, we have to give our 8 hours to our boss. Yes, very important. Don't slack. But ultimately, God is our boss. So we need to know where our north compass is, where our true north is. Next is the Perizzites. The Perizzite is lacking in discipline of boundaries. Anything goes, free and easy. So there's a saying in Proverbs 25, 28. What does this say in Proverbs 25, 28? I'd like to read it to you. Proverbs chapter 25, verse 28. It says, whoever has no rule over his own spirit is like a city broken down without walls. So it's important in life that we have boundaries and walls. Learning to say no, being assertive, sometimes can save your life. The Hivites, living out for number one. If it feels good, do it. It's a temporal well-being. What does the Bible say in 1 Timothy? Let's read that 1 Timothy. What does the Bible say in 1 Timothy? 1 Timothy, it says, chapter 6, verse 10. It says that, for the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. You've seen a lot of Christians. Wow, 赚钱啊。But at the end of the day, when bad times come, they leave their faith. We got to be centric. Who is our boss? He will look after us. Finally, the Jebusites is immoral activities. And I don't have to remind you what immoral activities are. And that's found in Matthew chapter 5, verse 27 and 28. So I just thought I'll draw a parallel between all this so that we can see a parallel between the actual enemies of Israel, the Hittites, the Gergesites, Amorites, and the spiritual enemies of fear, fickle-mindedness, and pride, arrogance, and being offended easily. And the Canaanites, Perizzites, Hivites, Jebusites, and the spiritual enemies of greed, lacking in discipline boundaries, living for temporal well-being, if it feels good, do it. And the Jebusite, which is engaging in more immoral activities. My dear brothers and sisters, I still got 10, 15 minutes, and then we will have our Holy Communion together. this part of our life is like refining silver. God gave the Holy Spirit to nudge us, to be a gift to us, to be a deposit for us, as a token of our bridal inheritance. The Holy Spirit gives us gift of wisdom, word of knowledge, faith, healings, tongues, interpretation of tongues. I used to share this, and I'll share this again, and then I'll share the video. This may not be true, but it feels good. Then I'll share you the actual process of refining silver. There was a group of women in a Bible study on the book of Malachi. As they were starting chapter 3, they came across verse 3, which says, "He will sit as a smelter and purifier of silver." This verse puzzled the women, and they wondered what this statement meant about the character and nature of God. So one of the women offered to find out about the process of refining silver and get back to the group at the next Bible study. So that week, the woman actually went over and to call a silversmith and made an appointment to watch him at work. She didn't mention anything about the reason for her visit, interest in silver, beyond her curiosity about the process of refining silver. As she watched the silversmith, he held a piece of silver over the fire and let it heat up. He explained that in refining silver, one needs to hold up the silver in the middle of the fire where the flames were hottest to burn away all the impurities. It's a bit long, so I'll cut short. At the end of the day, she asked, "How do you know that the silver has been refined?" The man answered that yes, he not only had to sit there holding, but he had to keep his eyes on the silver the entire time that it was in the fire. If the silver was left a moment too long, it would destroy. So the woman was silent. He says, "How do you know when the silver is fully refined?" He smiled at her and answered, "Oh, that's easy. When I see my image in it." When I see my image in it. My dear brothers and sisters, fellow believers, regardless of your denomination, Messianic, Christians, Hebraic, if today you're feeling the heat of the fire, remember Abba Father, our God, Avinu Malkeinu, has his eyes on you. Amen. He's not going to leave you alone. He's not going to abandon you. He's going to be with you all these times. I just want to show a little video here about purifying.
Hey guys, I brought you today to a precious metals refinery because I want to show you the process that metal goes through as it's being refined. Come take a look with me. Now the process of refining fine metal starts when gold, silver, platinum, and palladium are delivered to the refinery in several impure forms, some still connected to false teeth and other creepy stuff like that. The lots of precious metals are weighed and tabulated, then the lots are combined with flux, which looks a lot like you're actually making matters worse by pouring a bunch of dirty sand in with the metal, but it's actually a very important ingredient. This flux and the impure metal is placed in a vessel called a crucible. This is made from material that can take the heat better than the material inside it. So the crucible is then put into a melting furnace that transforms the metal and flux into a molten material, usually within 30 to 45 minutes. The crucible is then removed and the molten material is poured into a mold, sometimes shaped like a brick or other times like an inverted cone. Especially when they use a lot of flux in the cone-shaped mold, the flux fuses with the undesired matter to form a slag that is lighter than the precious metals. The slag naturally floats to the top of the mold, leaving a pure button of metal below. You can then easily separate the metal button from the slag. Once the whole lot has been melted and sampled, it's then remelted and recooled into grains about the size of BBs in order to speed up the extraction process. The grains are then placed into a mantle where an acid solution is used to dissolve the metals into a liquid form. Once the metals are fully dissolved, chemists use other substances to induce reactions that extract the exact metal they are looking for. The results are that you end up with an absolutely pure piece of gold, silver, platinum, or palladium. Now this process, although it may seem a little foreign to your typical day, is actually something that you need to understand inside and out. And here's why. The Bible, when it talks about God testing us, it doesn't use the definition for testing that we automatically think of. When we hear about tests, we think of exams and quizzes to see how much we've studied and how well we can answer those questions at a moment's notice. But man, have I got some great news for you today. When the Bible says that God tests us, it consistently uses the metallurgic term for refining precious metal. God does not test you to see how much you know or to find out where your breaking points are. He knows you inside and out. He knows the beginning, middle, and end. He already knows more about you than you do. So that's obviously why the Bible doesn't say that God is up there testing us like a difficult-to-please teacher at finals week. He's doing something completely different. He's trying to make you more precious. He's trying to make you more valuable, not in his eyes, but in the eyes of everyone else around you. He already values you so much that he paid the ultimate price to buy you back from the enemy. He's not testing to see how serious you are. He wants to purify you, to remove all of the things within you that are holding you back from the revolutionary that he created you to be. That's why you might be going through an experience right now that you feel like the heat has been really turned up in your life. Watching the refining process probably reminded you of this past year with all of these extreme conditions of heat, cold, and acid. Just know that you are safe as long as you are in God's crucible. He can use even these fiery trials to help you become more like him. And to begin to see that with each stage of the process, that he is strengthening you and healing you and purifying you in a way that will help you lean confidently into the indestructible arms of your loving God. So let him refine you a little bit more today. And don't get scared when he turns up the heat. He's just making you more precious.
Amen. Did you like that? It's beautiful. Christ has paid the price. The moha has been paid. And now we're going this process of refining our character. I'm not here as one preaching to you or down at you, speaking at you. I'm here as one journeying with you so that we can all grow together. So tonight is intentional. Regardless of your denomination, this message goes to the entire earth so that we can all learn. We are precious in God's eyes. And this process of refining is not because we are going to fail, but it's because we're preparing for his return. So don't focus on the great reset. Don't worry about eating bugs, cloud shop, and the social credit system, because then you get nervous. Yeah. Even Christians who go off grid fight amongst one another. Because I'm a lawyer. I'm more better than you. I'm a doctor. I'm an engineer. I know better than you. I know how to build a better house. Right? It's moments like these that God is actually purifying us. It's very, very important. I'm just about to end, and then we will have communion together. So those of you who actually have a bread, Charity, you got a bread, some bread? Thank you. I'd like to encourage you. So we're not going to go through the second video. Now, this is very important. I just learned about this quote today. It says that everything can only marry and nothing. Isn't that correct? The everything can only marry a nothing. I will share the links. So please join our Tough Ministries Telegram for those of you who are not on our Tough Ministries Telegram, because thank you, honey. My wife and I are full-time, working full-time, and we run ministries, teach Hebrew, you know, preparing for a lot of things. And we've been a bit fragile over the last couple of years because of things that happened. And, you know, with all these Fauci fungus and Kool-Aid that you have to take and stuff like that. And some here take, some here don't take. That's not the divide. But the focus tonight is that everything can only marry a nothing. So let that sink into you. That when he comes back, he's not going to come back for a bride with ego, jealousy, fight, you know, and so on. But he's going to come back for one who has nothing, who has become a nothing. Turn to your neighbor and say, I hope you are nothing. It's very, very deep spiritual truth there. That everything can only marry a nothing. Next slide. So some texts about purifying is all here, Malachi 3, Psalms 12:6. Don't worry about it. It's all going to be on the recording. Proverbs 25, Zechariah 39. You know, I will refine them as silver, Zechariah 39. You know, it's like the preparation. It's like the crushing of olive, which I'm not going to talk about today. You know, our life here is like the crushing of olives to bring out the oil. There's a beautiful book, Bishop Gavin R. Pritchard Sr., Crush Olive Releases Fresh Oil. Am I a pleasant aroma unto God? Remember the lady who came and took the perfume and anointed the feet of Yeshua? Lord, make our life every day beautiful aroma for you. Amen. So we'll talk about this another time. So this life is about consecration. This life is about, we have been set apart, the Kiddushin. Now we are holy before God. So therefore, we yield to the Holy Spirit to shape and mold our life. We're bought with a price. We're no longer ours. We're no longer mine. We have a boss. We have a father. Not the one in prison in Malaysia. That's not your boss. We need to die daily. 1 Corinthians 15:31. By the way, before I end, and let's do the Holy Communion. Did you notice this? There are three main categories of flesh. 1 John 2:16. Go back and read it tonight. 1 John 2:16. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, and pride of life. If you lump up everything from the Catholic Church seven definition of modern sin to the seven spiritual enemies, if you lump everything together, it's like the three temptations of Yeshua. Come. You fall down, I give you bread. May you turn the bread into stone. Come, show me. Turn the stone into bread. Fall down. I give you everything. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Finally, we're coming to the end. My dear brothers and sisters, believers in the kingdom of God, only the Father knows the day or the hour when the bridegroom will return to take the bride into the wedding chamber. Soon, the trumpet will sound. Someone says, I'm not looking for signs of the times. I'm listening for the sound of the trumpet. So later on, we'll have shofar before we close. And Dr. Ong, can you pray for us later? Thank you. And Miriam, can you do the Holy Communion? The Feast of Trumpets, Leviticus 23, verse 23 to 25. Soon the shofar will sound to signify the arrival of the bridegroom. We're all so familiar with this. The Passover is done. Unleavened bread is done. Feast of First Fruit is done. Pentecost is done. We're now finishing the church age. Yom Teruah, we just celebrated. You know, and these are the three unfulfilled feasts, Moedim, Moat, or the appointed times, or the festival of Feast of the Lord. Trumpet, Yom Kippur, and Sukkot. We are just moments away. It's done by my daughter. A different analogy in a circle. The trumpets, Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. I'll share this chart again on our Tough Ministries Telegram. You should be able to find it. Charity, can you just type in our Telegram channel on the chat so that those who are not there can actually join after tonight. Revelation 19:7. Let us rejoice and be glad and give glory to him, the glory to him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. It's part of the purification of silver. Interesting, the Bible used the word for purifying and refining. And just so that you look at the video of the brother, you know, he talked about that, the two similarities. And this is a very, very important Bible verse. We all need to say it together. Even when you're muted now, say with me, Ephesians 5:27, that he might present to himself the church in all her glory. No spot, no wrinkle, no Botox or any such thing, but that she would be holy, kadosh, and blameless, tamim. Yeah? That he as a chosen kozon might himself present to himself as his kala, the Brit Hadassah Kehila in all her kavod tamim, unblemished shemot vayikra, and without wrinkle or any such things, but that she may be kadosha and without blemish. So my dear brothers and sisters, this is my last slide. Let's continue to be focused, not on the great reset, but on the great return. Do not forget, do not be distracted by the seven mozi, but I mean the seven enemies. Copyrighted to Sister Miriam. Make sure we have sufficient oil in our lamp. and die. And I said, die! Die daily. Kill your mozibites. Amen? Die daily. Kill your mozibites. Praise God. So we need to all kill our mozibites. So let's continue to stay focused on the great return of Christ Yeshua, the bridegroom who is coming for the bride, the church. Regardless, you see Israel or the church as the bride, but let's prepare. Okay, let's not be pre-trip, mid-trip, post-trip, the bride is this and that, but let's focus and prepare for his great return. Let's not get distracted. Let's make sure we have sufficient oil. Let's continue to go through this purifying, refining. Let's die daily. So I need your help. I'm not going to ask for offering tonight, but more importantly, it's not about dollar. Your dollar doesn't matter to me. This Saturday, there'll be Sukkot 2022 at Taf. It'll be on the 8th of October, 2 p.m. till late. There'll be messages from Israel, from Messianic leaders, worship with Kathy Sasinja and Stephanie Truscott, and the Taf dance who have been practicing tirelessly for the last 7 weeks with our fearless leader and creative director, David Hadi, who's also happened to be a powerful and fearless school teacher as well. There'll be light dinner and fellowship. Please bring a dish. Bring less chocolate and bring more savory dish, okay? And some fruits. Be natural. Part of your purifying, okay? Less sweetened too. Overseas visitors and first-time guests are welcome. You still got 48 hours to come by Air Asia, Scoot, Malindo, Malaysian Airlines, Singapore Airlines. Or if you are a staff of Singapore Airlines, you can come free. Queue at the, start queuing now. The address will be Livestream Christian Church at the Rail Hall, Discovery Cove. We'd like to have you with us. There'll be worship, dance, greetings from Israel, teaching, food festival. So please come and join us. Bring a palm if you can. Bring those big palm, not the small little mini palm. Go and get a neighbor. Get the neighbor to cut some palms for you, 1.4, 1.5 meter, depending on the size of your car and how much you can carry. Bring them here, bring a dish, bring a friend. Let's spend time together and remember this joyful festival, the festival of tabernacles, or we call the Sukkot. So those of you who are in other parts of the world, please find your own Messianic congregation so that you can, even a family, you know, and do life together, yeah? This is not about Jew or Gentile or whatever, but this is about us remembering that he's coming back. That pen is sacred. Praise God. So before we go, we want to do communion together. So those of you who have the elements, the communion elements, let's do it together right now. So I'm just going to invite Sister Miriam to help us with the communion. And then I'm going to invite the shofar team to sound the shofar. And then I'm going to invite Dr. Ong. Our very honorable, respectful, one in a million Dr. Ong in the whole of WA to bless us with the closing blessing and prayer. So without further ado, thank you, Sister Clara. I'm glad everyone is here. Thank you for the insightful teaching. Don't thank me, thank the Lord. Praise God. This is a powerful teaching. Listen to it again and again because it will bless your heart. Thank you. That's my queen there. Yeah, I'm glad it is finished, but I'm not finished. The teaching is finished. Miriam will lead the communion, but tonight I'm not finished. I got some brownie point. I can sleep in the master bedroom, not in the car park. Very good. Thank you. Thank you. So the queen has said, okay, tick. When she turned on the camera, we're happy. When she don't turn on the camera, heartbeat fluttering, palpitation, tachycardia. Okay, Sister Miriam, Teacher Miriam, over to you. Baruch Hashem. Praise God. You need to unmute yourself, Sister Miriam, and Brother Egon, our fearless shofar warrior of Taf, SWAT team. Praise God. Sister Charity, can you kindly unmute Sister Miriam, please? Thank you, Lord. Hi, Vivian. Hello.
Hi.
One whole family there. Any quails? No quail, no chickens. Oh, only brothers, sisters, father, mother, Coco, Titi, Meme, Cheche. Very good. Sister Christine, tonight all full deck up. Sister Shalom, where are you? Okay, very good. Okay, Sister June, all very good. Okay, Sister Miriam, please.
Yeshua, we thank you, Lord, for what you have done on the cross for us. You have obtained eternal redemption for us. It was your great love that took you to the cross to take our place, to bear our sins and the sins of the world. And whosoever will may come, the invitation is open to anyone who wants to come to be saved. So we thank you what you have done for us. Your body was broken for us. You experienced torture, but you did it because of your great love for us. So we thank you, Lord. And I'll say the prayer in Hebrew. Baruch ata Yahweh Eloheinu melech haolam ha-motzi lechem min haaretz. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, creator who brings forth bread from the earth. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let us take the bread and thank him. Thank you, Yeshua. We thank you, Lord, for what you have done with your blood. Amen. Your word says that without the shedding of blood, there is no redemption. There is no forgiveness of sins. Amen. And we thank you, Lord, that every part of your blood, every precious drop was used to appease the Father. Amen. So that we can have this relationship with you in eternity. We can never thank you enough, Lord. We thank you so much for the blood. Baruch ata Yahweh Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri hagafen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, creator of the fruit of the vine. Amen. And we will partake of the wine, which represents his blood. And we thank you, Lord. We thank you so much forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Maureen, Sister Miriam. Father, we just want to thank you for tonight. May every word that has been spoken by me that is of the flesh be removed. May every word that is from you continue to be embedded deeply into the hearts and minds of your believers. May this be fresh oil for them. May they continue to be filled with wisdom and discernment as we prepare together for these last days. We thank you, Lord, for your kindness and your chesed love through your covenant, steadfast faithfulness through the ages. And we remember the coming bridegroom. May the church prepare wherever we are, whoever we are. We bless your name, Abba Father. In mighty name of Christ, Yeshua, we pray. Amen. So with that, we just want to sound the shofar before Dr. Ong graces us. Those of you who have not heard the sound of the shofar, and some of you said that you have not heard a Jewish prayer, a Hebrew prayer for a long while. So I gather you're either from Malaysia or Singapore, got the wah and the lay and the low. Very good. Okay. If you'd like to learn biblical Hebrew, sponsor me. I'll come back in December to teach you personally. No payment, just sponsor my air ticket. Okay. Challenge you to get 8 students. I'll be there anytime, rain or shine. Okay. The shofar team, Sister Shalom, please. Praise God. Hallelujah. You need to unmute yourself, Sister Shalom. There we go. Praise God. Sister Helena, get ready as well. After Sister Shalom will be Sister Helena. Thank you. So that there's no confusion. Hold on. Yep. Shalom will go first. Charity, can you unmute Sister Shalom first? And then you unmute Sister Helena. Praise God.
Thank you.
There we go. Praise God. Thank you. And over to Sister Helena. Charity, can you unmute Sister Helena, please? Thank you. No problem, Shu. You're welcome. I'll see you soon. Praise God. Sister Helena, you're on live. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you. And we'll just cross over live right now to Dr. Ong for the closing benediction. Thank you, Dr. Ong. Charitie, can you kindly unmute Dr. Ong, please? Thank you. Praise God. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Yeah.
Dr. Ong, over to you.
Okay, let's pray. Father, first and foremost, we give you all the praise and all the glory. We thank you, Lord, heart, that you made it possible for us to review your word, to be instructed and to be taught. Thank you for your servant, David. Thank you for Sister Miriam. Thank you for those who are working hard to enrich us and bless us through your powerful word. We are grateful to you. We thank you. From the depth of our heart, we give you all the glory. It's almost unbelievable that you make us your bride.
Amen.
Not you're just your wife, but your bride, that you're coming to pick to take us home. And you've paid the price. You've given the most painful and precious price that you've given. You want to take us home. So, Lord, we are very, very grateful to you. You want us to live for you. You set us apart to live for you. Lord, this precisely is what we want to do. Be sanctified for you. Be consecrated to you. We have got no other husband. We have got no other admirer. We just want you. And we worship you and give you all the praise and all the glory. We thank you, Lord, that you're refining us. We thank you, Lord, that you're protecting and looking after us. No evil is going to befall us because Amen. You are with us. You are our bridegroom. Lord, we praise you. We thank you for such unspeakable love, unexpressible love. We worship you and we want to live our life for you, just for you and for you alone. Praise you and thank you. Thank you for this good time, for the good time here. Thank you for your powerful word. Thank you, Lord, for your servant, the Jewish people, who for generations prepare your powerful word so that we can read your word and understand what is in your heart. We worship you and praise you and give you all the glory. We bless our Jewish brethren. We thank you as we coming to Sukkot. We remember the wonderful things, the heritage that you have in them. And we bless our Jewish brethren. The peace, the mercy, and the grace of the Lord be upon them. That Israel be safe to the glory Amen. Of God.
Amen.
Praise you and thank you. Father, we thank you for the Aaronic blessings that you've given us. We are grateful and we receive them and give you all the glory. And I bless this, speak this word to your people tonight. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Lord, we receive them. Give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's speak the blessing together for your family and friends. Yevareka Adonai ve'ishmereka. Ye'er Adonai panav elecha vihunika. Yisa Adonai, panav elecha, ve'yasem lecha shalom. Thank you very much at the board of Taf, Sister Miriam, Egon, and Charity for being here. And thank you very much for many of you from different nations, different churches, and denominations who have so graciously been so patient. It's coming close to 2 hours, so I'm going to just say thank you, Sister Shalom, for coming again. Thank you to many of you who are new to this teachings and so on. So I see a lot of new faces. Thank you to familiar faces like our Eagle Sister Ta Jie Joyce Cheng, who is so faithful and returning to pick up more gleans and so on. Thank you so much, Sister Carmen, and every one of you who has been so patient, Pastor Ozzy and Pastor Daniel and Doris and everyone. I hope those of you who are local can make it to our festival this Saturday. Come and join us regardless how late, how early you are. Come and help us to set up the place, go home. This is not our festival, this is his festival. We are family together. So regardless of your persuasion and belief, let's do that. We are family, we are mishpaha, yeah? So thank you very much. I just want to bless you. Thank you so much. I hope that this has been a blessing to you. We will upload this to Rumble and YouTube so that you actually have multiple platforms to share this with your friends and your cell group and so on. So thank you very much. And everyone, we're so happy that you are here with us. Thank you. And good night, Lila Tove. Thank you to my wife, Charity. And thank you, Stella, Elaine, Joyce, Lina, Vivian, Shalom, Clara, Lilette, Judy, Sam, Sega, Dr. Ong, Connie Lam, Dennis Chow from Melbourne. Praise God. Always faithful follower here. Thank you. S. Kim, Susie, Professor Susie, Dr. John, and Professor John, Dr. Susie, and Ivy. And thank you, every one of you. I will see you and hand the time to Charitie. Praise God. Hallelujah.